Amen. I suppose, like many of you, when I came to faith in Christ without much help from my parents, though they were utterly wonderful and loving, but in a community of believers that just so impressed me by their example that really I had no trouble believing the Bible. And I can't quite explain that. I suppose I'd heard enough in the things they shared and by their own confidence in the Word, but when they would talk about Jesus, it was clear that he had absolute confidence in Scripture, and so I saw no reason not to as well. And I gather that I'm not exceptional in that the very first book that was thrust into my hand was a little miniature version of the Gospel of John. It's the practice, and it was in those days, of many evangelistic groups, Billy Graham, Crusade, standard procedure was to begin with this book that is the book that Walter has been preaching on in great detail, and we've come to know and love because of that. But hey, we've been living with it probably right from the beginning of your walk with the Lord. It's the ideal guide to start with. It's an ideal guide for many reasons, and for this new Christian, being only high school age at the time, it was helpful that there's a kind of simplicity about it. The language, for one thing, is simple. I wasn't reading it in Greek, but if you looked in Greek, you would discover that the book has 15,673 words in that length. Nevertheless, there's just 1,013 vocabulary items. This is why any students who have ever studied New Testament Greek, the first book you read in the Bible is the Gospel of John, because it's not only very few words, but very simple words. And compared to other books, you're impressed with this fact. For example, the Gospel of Luke has almost twice the vocabulary in the same volume as does the Gospel of John, and Hebrews has three times the vocabulary in the same space. So that Hebrews is like the last book you read when you're studying Greek. But John is easy. And it's not just easy, but it has the benefit for a new believer that it has lots of repetition, as you've discovered, as you've been reading along with Walter. And the key terms, particularly, you just can't like miss the main point because it's made over and over again. There's a great deal about knowing. 141 times. That's greater than the sum use of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's a clear emphasis, knowing. And it isn't just intellectual knowing. Tonight, this message may at first kind of sound intellectual, academic, but actually, if you're reading the Gospel of John, it's all about knowing Jesus and knowing the Father because Jesus makes him known. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So it's not just head knowledge, as we put it, it's life knowledge. And the Father, it's Jesus as the Son that makes us understand who the Father is in reality. And he promises that the same love the Father has for him will now be in us. That God the Father will love us in the very way that he loves his only begotten Son. You can't get a higher measure of love than that. And of course, the book's all about believing. Three times the number of times in Matthew, Mark, and Luke combined, we read the word believe in one or another of its forms. Love, of course, is what the Gospel of John is all about. In fact, if you are trying to have messages about ethics, you almost never quote John, because he doesn't have a lot of ethical instruction. There isn't a Sermon on the Mount. As recorded in John. It's really all just boiled down for those of us who are beginners. We want it real clear. It is all about love. We are to love. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. If you didn't know what gospel that came from, if you see the word love, just guess John. It's from John. You're right. You got it. Likewise, I've made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that they might, the love that you have for me may be in them. Here's Jesus in his high priestly prayer referring to the Father's love for the Son and saying that love will now be in us. as we wear the righteousness of Christ and are transformed into his likeness, that that love for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. It's the indwelling Christ. The word life and live, again, twice as often as in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Truth, three times the number of times it occurs in total in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The Son, his Son, your Son, only begotten. These terms, yes, the other Gospels have the Son of God and the Son of Man particularly, but not just the Son. The Son, standing in absolute form, referring to the Savior. And of course, it's a great book with which to begin your walk with God because it really nails the foundational truths of our faith about who Jesus is and how we might be saved. In fact, we don't even have to guess what the purpose of the book is. It was read for us in the text that was read. These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ. Do you yet believe that? If not, this is the book to go to. The Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So it's not just, again, head knowledge. It's having a life transform. So we have life. You know, people often say, get a life. That's a wonderful injunction. But how do you get a life if you don't have one? The only life worth getting is the life that Jesus is prepared to give to you in the Gospel of John. It's all about that life. The Gospel of John isn't just a beginner's book, however, it's also the ideal guide to keep you walking with God. It just gets better and better as you examine and live this book and have the Lord write its lessons on your heart. These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, is that closing passage, but some of you may be aware, if you read it in other Bibles, they often translate it that you may keep believing. And to be honest, the Greek, well, could be read either way, but the better reading is probably the present tense and better translated, keep believing. That this is not a book just to get you to believe. What the Lord is after and what John, the inspired author, are after is keeping that belief. And it may be a shock to you to realize that as followers of Christ, we have to become followers of Christ every day, all over again. Yes, it's a once-for-all thing in one respect, maybe from heaven's perspective, but at least I find you need to become a Christian every single day. You got to keep believing, not just, well, I believed, I remember I went forward when I was in ninth grade. That doesn't cut it. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are the four Gospels in the New Testament, the four books with which the New Testament begins. And the order, this order, the canonical order of these books, it's not inspired of God, but it definitely is wise. These books are placed up front, not because they're the first books that were written. They almost certainly were not. Much more likely 1 Thessalonians was the very first book of the New Testament to be written. And you can read it if you want to, and you'll see it has the same message that the last book has. But you start with these four because they're the story of Jesus Christ. They're the account of the Savior. But why the order that we find them in? Why Matthew first, then Mark, then Luke, then John? And, well, you know, I'll admit, Billy Graham doesn't give out Matthew. And most organizations don't, because in 2015, well, Matthew begins with a lengthy genealogy. And unless you really get excited about reading telephone books or something, you're going to lose the inquirer, the seeker, on the very first page. If you could get beyond the first page, you'll be okay. But for us, in our culture, we're not really interested in the genealogy. And the New Testament world isn't generally either. It's not like everyone's interested in who your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grand, I go back to Noah, frankly. You know, we're not really interested in that. They weren't then either. But they are interested when it comes to inheriting the throne of David. And Matthew's point, the reason he begins with this is not to bore us, but maybe to tell us that, you know, individuals do count, even the ones you and I don't know about. In God's economy, they all matter. Every one of us matters. And secondly, this particular line matters because Jesus is the son of David, the son of Abraham. And that's where we sum it up, and it begins with that. But the order, then, isn't maybe the greatest order for sharing with others. Start with Matthew and hold your breath for a chapter. It is, however, a wise order because I think, in fact, the Gospel of John is intended to be read last. The Gospel of John is, in fact, from the late second century, seen as kind of a capstone, a kind of an advanced graduate course in Christianity. Clement of Alexandria in the late second century said, John, last of all, conscious that the outward facts had been set forth in the other Gospels, was urged on by his disciples and divinely moved by the Spirit, composed a spiritual gospel. Now, John is profound. It's advanced in every respect. Awesome and inspiring character. Just think of where it begins. The other gospels walk you into the faith, and you're discovering the evidence just alongside of the disciples that this, you know, who is it that makes the wind and the waves to obey his voice? I mean, what kind of man is this? The disciples are asking that, and you're asking yourself as you read it. But John begins with like a nuclear bomb in chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is even before you meet the guy. And it goes on from there. In fact, there are 18 major titles, major descriptions of Jesus in his awesome glory in the very opening chapter of John. He's called the Word, who is God, the true light, the one and only Son, the one that's greater than Moses, the one through whom the world began, the Messiah, the Christ, God, the prophet. He's the Lord, capital L, capital O-R-D. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's the Son of God. He's the Rabbi, the teacher of teachers, the King of Israel, the Son of Man. He's all of that and much more beside. And that's right in the first church, the very first chapter. You have to know a lot. You have to have been a Christian a long time to even pick up on all of these allusions. He's the one where the angels are going to ascend and descend. And you're supposed to know about Jacob's ladder, the staircase to heaven that Jacob dreamt about. And Jesus is the intersection between heaven and earth. You won't even get it without knowing the Old Testament. And of course, Walter's preaching has brought that out over and over again, hasn't it? But so this is the gospel you start with, and it's the one you never let go of. Because of all the gospels, all four of them, yes, tell us about what Jesus did and what he taught, how we should live because of what he did, all of that. But this gospel really is supremely about the person of Jesus Christ, just who he is, simply who he is, and all the ways you can approach who he is and describe it. He who is the gate, he is the light of the world, he's it all, the resurrection and the life, he's it all. All the things that we could ever need, they're all summed up in him. The Gospel of John then really is meant to be read after the other Gospels, after you know the story. It assumes you know the story. In some passages, you'll have like John 1 chapter, first chapter, where we're told Andrew, and he's introduced as Simon Peter's brother. You say, well, where did I get to know Simon Peter? In the other Gospels, when Peter's introduced as Simon, you meet him, and his name Peter then is given to him a little later on, and they're careful to build on ignorance to knowledge. John assumes you already know this, and so he doesn't even tell you. He doesn't even tell you about John the Baptist being put into jail, into prison, but he wants to locate an event, and he assumes you already know that. And by the way, he never says John the Baptist. That's how we know it was John who wrote this. He never calls John the Baptist John the Baptist. That comes in the other Gospels, the ones that weren't written by John. The one that was written by the Apostle John When he speaks about John the Baptist, he just calls him John. That's because he never gets confused which one is John the Baptist or not, you know. That's another proof that this gospel, a very subtle proof, but the very kind that are most compelling, that John the Apostle wrote this. You're getting this right from an eyewitness, from one who walked with the Savior. And we could look at other ones as well, other examples where stories are told that you're supposed to know about, and I'm not going to. He talks about the 12. He never even tells you who they are. He never tells you the story of Jesus' appointment of the apostles, because first he knows it pretty well. He's one of them. And he knows you know it because you don't read this until you're advanced in your walk with God and more or less have the facts down. So, yeah, it's a great gospel to start with because it's all about what you need to know and said simply at one level. But it's also an advanced gospel that you never outgrow your need. If you haven't read it lately, you need to read it again. Don't just listen to sermons about it. Read it. And so, of course, he omits things that he doesn't need to tell you about, and I'm not going to tell you about them either. I want to move ahead. Instead, he fills in crucial gaps, and so you'll discover as you read this gospel that it's telling you all about parts of the ministry that you didn't know about. An earlier part, Matthew, Mark, and Luke tell us about the ministry of Jesus that probably all took about a year, and that's it, less maybe even. All of it could fit into less than 1 year. It's all about one trip virtually, at least from the midpoint on to Jerusalem, and Jesus just celebrates one Passover, as far as we know, in the other Gospels, and therefore you could say it could all have happened in his adult ministry in 1 year. It wasn't 1 year, but it could have been, as far as Matthew, Mark, and Luke tell you. They just focus on 1 year. John tells us about three Passovers. John gives us the back information, the early Judean ministry and the Samaria ministry that Jesus had that you don't learn about, and an earlier time when Jesus cleansed the temple in addition to the later. And in fact, if you didn't know about the earlier, you'd be very surprised at the things that are said in the other Gospels when they complain that he said that in 3 days I'm going to rebuild this temple. He only says that at the earlier occasion recorded in John. The complaint is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but the actual event is in John. So I say, John, that's the gospel to go if you're a graduate student and really wanting to think deeply, deeply about the things of the Lord, and it's the ideal guide to help you finish strong with God. It'll take you right to the end. And it took John. Don't ever let it go. Keep it with you, right in the pocket and more in your heart, because you don't outgrow it. We know John is the one that we need because it's really all, the gospel is all about who Jesus is, and you never exhaust your knowledge of him. You know, the facts of his birth, which town it was, that you can get, but you do not exhaust who Jesus is, the awesome one who is presented to us. All the miracles that John records, the seven miracles, are all called signs because all they are intended to do is point to Jesus, every one of them. You know, when he feeds the multitudes, he's on the bread of life. You know, when he opens the eyes of the blind, I'm the light of the world. When he raises Lazarus from the grave, I'm the resurrection and the life. They're all signposts to him, as we've been reminded before. It's all about who Jesus is, and secondarily, what he did for us and what he demands of us. And so, as I say, it's a great one to go old by. Jerome tells the story of when John the Apostle, the author of this gospel, was very elderly. He was so old, he was so infirm, he could no longer walk to church. And so the other members of the church would actually carry him to church. And, you know, it wasn't really clear. People were beginning to wonder, you know, when you get that infirm, maybe other stuff's infirm about you. And it did seem like he did a lot of repeating. And apparently, according to John, some of the folks, you know, would ask, well, you know, why do you keep repeating yourself over and over again? He just keeps saying, my little children, love one another. And you know, and then they say, well, okay, you know, you said that last time, John. It's, you know, thanks. You know, why do you say it? It's the Lord's commandment, and if you keep it, that alone suffices. He hadn't lost his mind. He was just keeping his focus. The focus, the repeated focus, the embodiment of love in Christ that then calls us to a life of love. How do we get this gospel? Well, if you ask Dan Brown, it's all about power politics. Brown has got this view that has become quite popular, that it was originally there were lots of gospels based on apparently the Gospel of Thomas. The original gospels didn't have anything about Jesus' death and resurrection. Jesus was just a religious genius. He had a lot of wise things to say. And the Gospel of Thomas is a collection of 114 of those wise things. No miracles. This is kind of a Jesus that a Thomas Jefferson could get into, you know, a Jesus who's, you know, kind of like Ben Franklin, actually. He says a lot of wise things, didn't do that much that would offend anybody, and certainly didn't die or rise again from the dead. Or is the Gospel of John in there not because of power politics, not because Constantine decided that we're going to need to unite the kingdom with a religion, the Roman Empire, and so he then calls supposedly the Council of Nicaea to then create a creed and we'll get rid of the books that don't agree. That's not why. It's not power politics. Keep in mind, Dan Brown, it's a novel. Enjoy the story. It's all made up. And all the so-called high-thinking comments about extra-biblical gospels, oh, I mean, he's right, there are extra-biblical gospels. But as you're going to see in a moment, they're not at all to be relied upon. It isn't the story he tells. It's another story altogether. I know we're used to thinking, unfortunately, of churches doing power politics and having scandals and cover-ups. And so it was a great timing for that book. But unfortunately, it's reading into what actually happened in a way that completely misleads. The Gospel of John is in there because the Council of Nicaea actually didn't make it, as they did not make any of the books that we have in our Bible in the Bible. They didn't put books in the Bible. All they were doing was recognizing and acknowledging what had always been the case. That was the entire point. They were only interested in the books that were ancient, that is, that actually came from the time of Jesus, written by those who knew him or would have been have access to those who knew him. They weren't interested in anything other than first century books, period. In fact, they wanted them all apostolic. It's not everything that was written in the first century. It's just the stuff that came from the apostles, authorized by Jesus, in accord with all the things that Jesus had taught and what was taught elsewhere in Scripture, and accepted right from the get-go, not waiting for the fourth century to get accepted, but accepted right from the beginning, hot off the press, the moment John, the gospel was written, then taken seriously. Paul, for example, the moment he wrote his letters, no one voted to make them the Bible. He urged that everyone read this, it'd be publicly read when the Christians gathered, because in those days, you only read the Bible. And he understood the Holy Spirit's empowerment for writing these letters, and so actually presumed to say, oh yes, read the Scriptures and this. And that's why Peter right away calls Paul's writings Scripture. Ancient. The Gospel of Thomas is not. It comes from almost or more than 100 years later than any of the books of the New Testament. It's not ancient. No one was alive who knew Jesus when the Gospel of Thomas was put together. And it has a lot of crappy stuff in it, things you wouldn't much care for, like how about saying 114? Simon Peter said to him, supposedly to Jesus, that is, let Mary leave us, for women are not worthy of life. Jesus said, I myself shall lead her in order to make her male, so that she too can become a living spirit resembling you males. For every woman who will make herself male will enter the kingdom of heaven. It sounds like a mandate for transgender or something. It's, you know, what is going on here? Well, it's Gnosticism playing in to distorting all the teachings of Christianity and adding to them in ways that undermine everything that Christ taught. Yes, there's liberty. You know, I mean, the gospel concern in the New Testament over and over again is to elevate women in ways that the culture was heading in this direction, in, to denigrate them. This is not the Word of God, but it's filled with quotes from the Bible. In fact, from almost every book in the New Testament, that's how we know it's so old, it's so late. The Gospel of Mary Magdalene that Dan Brown makes so much of, it nowhere teaches that Jesus had a thing with Mary. It does not actually say that anywhere in the, it's baloney, but it neither does it say that which people imagine based on the Da Vinci Code. The Gospel of Philip, he depends much more on, and the Gospel of Philip does talk about Jesus kissing Mary. And of course, the New Testament has five texts where we're told we're supposed to greet one another with a holy kiss. A kiss is not marriage or an intimacy, a kind of sexual intimacy that's going on. It's completely misread by Dan Brown's characters. And then there's all this other garbage that's out there too. Infancy Gospel Thomas, that's, you know, didn't you ever wonder what Jesus did when he was 5 years old? You know, these just fill in the blanks. Misguided imagination. Someone came up with the idea, Infancy Gospel of Thomas. I wonder what Jesus did when he was five. Oh, I know. He made little 12 little mud doves, and all of a sudden they flew. You know, it was like, and then someone bumped into him, and he killed them. It was one of the other playmates, you know, was when he was like 5 or 6. Oh, and then the parents came and were upset with him, and he struck them blind. Because, you know, if you're Jesus, you know, you can do all that kind of stuff, right? Infancy Gospel of James, the same thing, only there his diapers. You couldn't burn them. They could heal lepers and so on. It's all crazy stuff. I suppose if you can't burn the diaper, you might as well use it for something. But curing lepers is kind of beyond. Why did this junk get all written? I often think of it as like an octopus or a squid. This is a giant Pacific octopus, doesn't matter, could have been a squid. It's Satan's game plan, apparently, that, you know, when there's truth, he loves, if you can't defeat it, you then just smother it with ink, more ink, until there's so much, there are scores and scores of these phony gospels written in the second, third, and fourth centuries, more than you could read. They make for amusing reading, but they are no substitute for the truth. And by the way, in that ink, you know, the ink of the octopus is covered with mucus too. It's not just ink, it's all gooey. And so you get the ink, if you start getting into the ink, it gets sticking all over you. I advise avoiding it altogether. You know, stick with the true book, the Word of God. It won't have this unpleasant result. Anyway, it's ancient. We could talk about, we in fact have a copy of a portion of John. It was until recently the oldest portion of the entire New Testament. It's dated about 125 AD. We know this is both sides. It was written on both sides. This is John 18:31 and following. Here's John 18:37 and following. You say, well, that's nice, but that's not much. That's just a little tidbit. But it turns out every single letter here is exactly the same as other copies that we have, another papyrus from the end of the second century and another uncial from the third or fourth century, exactly the same. So it's very encouraging to have a perfectly identical copy of these verses and then validating apparently well-preserved texts that we do have from John 1 all the way to 21. Okay, you get it? All you need is a few tests like this to show that over time, these copies in this early period were actually remarkably well-preserved. And if you have a copy dating from 125, the original is clearly before it. This is a copy then, in Egypt, of a book that John wrote up in Ephesus, the Gospel of John. It must have taken a lot of time to make copies to get all the way down there. And all I would say is that shows it's a lot older than the Gospel of Thomas or any of these other junky things. Anyway, there are other examples of quotes. We could look at the evidence that it was written by John. I would just say, let me just give you an example of this. At the end, when we read, you might say, well, it says, this is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. I don't know if you heard that, you know, and then Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written, the world wouldn't contain it. What's this we stuff? Scholars look at this with a microscope and decided that, oh, there must have been a committee that wrote the Gospel of John. It pretends to be written by the apostle, but then in the end, we get the real deal. It's a group of people putting their heads together and doing their best. Well, that's what scholars are capable of inventing when they're not looking at facts, and they don't have the background to make a speculation like that. If we look more deeply, Richard Baucom, who used to teach up at St. Andrews, is now at University of Cambridge, he points out this is the well-attested we of authoritative testimony that you get in the ancient world in Greek writings. Thucydides, Xenophon, Polybius, Julius Caesar himself, Dionysius writing at the same time as the New Testament, Josephus a little after the New Testament. Every once in a while, they break into a we statement to bear testimony. It was a way of speaking that says, I vouch that everything I'm saying is absolutely true. We would think of this in terms of modern practices in a courtroom, things said under oath. It's a way of expressing yourself that way. And Jesus even uses the we. I tell you the truth, we speak of what we know. And we testify to what we have seen. The moment you have testimony, like in a court of law, you go into the we discourse, and Jesus does it too, even though Jesus is not referring to himself in the plural because, well, there's spirit and soul and body and, you know, multiple parts or something. It's not that. They're not a group of Jesuses there. It's just Jesus bearing witness with a we. Baucom goes on and says, by the way, you know, you can tell a phony gospel from a real one very easily if you know about Greek in the biblical languages because of names. How many people here have the name Patience? Anybody? How about Capability? Any capabilities? These are names that were very popular in the 18th and 19th centuries, but they are not at all popular in the 21st century. We like other names. I don't know what, you know, we could combine them. We'd realize there are very few Gordons now. It's kind of falling out of favor for lots of reasons. You're welcome to use it, however, trying to beef this up if you have a little one. But anyway, yeah, we don't use, you can tell when a book is written based on the names they use. And Baucom has a very extensive registry of names based on legal documents and inscriptions from the first centuries B.C. and A.D., actually going back to the 4th century B.C., but the ones he used, he just was interested in the ones in the first century, the time of Jesus. And he found out there are 2,953 occurrences, datable occurrences, of funerary inscriptions, of marriage documents that you can date and know exactly what the names of Jewish people were living in Israel at that time. And we also have them breakdown of male. They tend to have much, much greater variety in the male names than female names. And he actually produces a list for us. I could give you the whole list. I'm just going to give you the 12 most common and then a 17th one. But here are the most common names for Palestinian Jews living in Judea at the time. Simon wins, Joseph is number two, and so on. Just for comparison, at the same time in Egypt, these were the favorites. Dosthenes or something, how do you even pronounce that? Pappus and Ptolemaeus, these are like, they look very different. The hit list is different geographically and time-wise. You move one century and they're different in either direction. You move one country away and they're different. Here are the women's names. The women's names are, there are fewer of them because they really used very much some of the lower numbered names. This is all ordered lists. Mary is number one. Out of all the names they had, 70 of the women had the name Mary, and so on. Now, let's apply this. Is it a case, you look at the Gospel of John and you collect all the names that are mentioned. There are 19 men, four women that are Jewish and one Gentile. The 19 men and the four women all have well-attested names from the first century, ones that fit like a glove. In fact, it turns out 9 of the men had the 10 most common names, and 4 of the women had the 4 most common names. In fact, 3 of the women had the first most common. They're all these Marys. Everyone's name is Mary if you're a woman. Now, that's because Mary is the Greek form of Miriam, the sister of Moses, and so it's kind of going back to an important person. One non-Jewish name, that's Pilate, and we can validate it. It was spelled correctly in Kerr's inscriptions and so on. We know exactly that there was a... But here's the coincidence. If we gather together the names in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Acts, so we have a statistically significant number of names, and compare them to what was the practice among the Jews in Israel at the time of Jesus, 16% of those men bore either Simon or Joseph as their names. If you look in the Gospels, including John, and the book of Acts, 18% of the men have either the name Simon or Joseph. 42% of the men, in terms of the inscriptions, had the 9 most popular names, one or the other of them. I mean, almost half the people. So you only need to know 9 names and you can pretty well cover the territory. 40% of the males in the Gospels and Acts have one of those 9 names. Do you see how this fits like a glove? This is exactly, I mean, it's statistically a miracle if these books had been invented and written in the second century or had been written somewhere else in describing the main characters whose names we have. Likewise of the women, 29% of the Jewish women in those various inscriptions had the name Mary or Salome. They just really love those names. 39% of them have it in the Gospels. Well, of course, there are fewer numbers, so, but it's, you know, in terms of the margin for error, incredibly close. Likewise, 50% of the Jewish females bore one of the 9 most popular names. In the Gospels, 61%. And we say, well, how does that compare to, you know, some and all of them are spelled perfectly. Sometimes you'd have the same name that would change spelling over time. Spelling conventions change, as you know. How about one of the other phony gospels? Well, maybe phony. Let's see if it is. How about, or one of the phony Acts? There's an Acts of Philip, one that happens to be Jacobovich was using it in Pellegrino for their Jesus family tomb. You may have seen this on, if you read the history, watch the History Channel or whatever. The Acts of Philip, these scholars depend on, and sure enough, Mary is the most common name, and it's a name that's used in the Acts of Philip, and so they get a plus. But wait a minute, it was the wrong spelling. Instead of spelling it the way it was in the first century, when Mary, the mother of Jesus, had her name, they're spelling it like it was in the fourth century. So it's apparently not, that's not good enough, you see. They made a mistake. The Acts of Philip can include other names, Iraeus, who's ever seen that? Artemella, Aristarchus, none of them are attested in the first century. The thing is filled with fake names for the period. You know, in the book that is based on it should just be thrown away. It has no historical validity. We could look at examples, by the way, of other historical confirmations. Let me go to one. I'll go to jump ahead here. I want to go to Pool of Siloam. I thought I had that. Sorry. Hang on. Okay, it won't let me. Well, okay, I want to jump ahead to the Pool of Siloam, which is mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter 9. This is where Jesus was healing the man born blind, told him to go wash in the Pool of Siloam, and he went and washed and came home seeing. And earlier scholars said, what are the chances of having a pool named Send? Have Jesus send a man to a pool named Send? And John tells you the thing means send. All right? So here's the wash in the Pool of Siloam. This word means sent. He mentions this. And so it was a tradition among scholars to say this is all made up. They're making up a story based on a name. And then the 4th century, somebody foolishly decided to build a pool in Jerusalem, which they named Siloam. And it clearly is not, it wasn't existing at the time of Jesus. And so the scholars assume here's a historical error in the Gospel of John. However, it turns out that in June 2004, a bunch of workers in Jerusalem were fixing some sewer pipes in the old city, and an archaeologist happened to be watching while they were digging. And they happened to unearth 2 steps, which they wouldn't have otherwise told anyone about, except the archaeologist was there. That stops everything if it's an archaeological find. And sure enough, praise God, it did stop, because this is what was found. A 225-foot side of massive stairs, and they are in groups that have like a landing. So there are 3 groups with a landing in between. They actually form a complete square. This is just one side, and it's exactly where the Pool of Siloam was supposed to be. It's being fed by, in fact, where the new sewer is there, if you're worried, they managed to keep it there for the pilgrims. The pilgrims are up here coming. There's where the pool is. Doesn't look very clean, but originally it was really wonderful. This confirms the accuracy of Scripture. And I got an article out of the Los Angeles Times, this is in 2005, an article where they said, scholars have said that there wasn't a Pool of Siloam and that John was using a religious conceit to illustrate a point. James Charlesworth of Princeton Theological Seminary, who's not a fundamentalist Bible thumper, points this out. Now we have found the Pool of Siloam exactly where John said it was. A gospel that was thought to be, quote, pure theology is now shown to be grounded in history. Well, of course, it's not surprising. There are so many such examples of this. Let me finish with, not that, but with this, if I can get it. Come on. Okay, don't want to do this. I'm going to jump ahead. How about the nailing? As you know, the only mention of Jesus being nailed to the cross is an indirect mention in the Gospel of John. And a lot of people think, well, John was written later. Maybe he kind of got carried away. Theological imagination, developing ideas that weren't original or historical. Maybe he was becoming senile. No. He has Thomas saying, we've seen the Lord, but Thomas said, unless I see the nail prints in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it. Thought to be an invention, an exaggeration of what crucifixion was by rope hanging. But in fact, though critical scholars were trying to dump on it, it turns out that in 1968, on Ammunition Hill, just outside Jerusalem, again, workers were just digging around, and all of a sudden stumbled upon the remains of the one and only crucified victim whose remains had been found up to that point. And sure enough, strangely enough, the heel bone right here on the, I think it was the right side, it still has the nail embedded in it. And originally they constructed this as it, but rethinking it, realizing that actually the nail couldn't have gone through 2 heel bones, they now know this is how it was, only without the cloth, the modesty cloth. The reason crucifixion was done this way was to increase the shame of it, the humiliation, so that Jesus being nailed to the cross would be in this position that would be deeply humiliating to him. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Indeed, may that be exactly what we do. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we ask that you might enable us not to be those who study the scripture but fail to experience that for which you have given your word. That it's by the scriptures we possess eternal life because they point us to you and enable us to know you better, to know our own desperate need for you that will be met in no other way than by surrendering ourselves to you, unrivaled Lord of our lives. Oh Lord, from the inside out, transform us, we pray. Speak to us with the same omnipotent power with which you spoke the universe into existence and said, "Let there be light." Change us, and may this summer into which we are entering be the best we have ever had, because we are walking more closely with you than ever before. We pray in your name. Amen.